Good morning, everyone, and can I welcome you to the ninth meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. The first item on the agenda is for the committee to decide whether to consider its annual report for the parliamentary year from the 11th of May 2015 to the 23rd of March 2016 and its legacy paper in private at its next meeting. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Second item on the agenda today is to take evidence from the ScotRail Alliance. Following the committee's inquiry into access to Scotland's major railway stations, Phil Verster, the Managing Director of the ScotRail Alliance, committed to updating the committee on matters raised in its inquiry, as well as providing a general update on the operations of the ScotRail Alliance. I welcome Phil Verster, Managing Director at the ScotRail Alliance, and I invite Mr. Verster to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. Members of the committee, really appreciate the opportunity to being here. I found the comments and questions at the previous meeting very helpful, and I hope that our correspondence and answers that we've given has helped to clarify some of the questions raised. Going forward, in whatever shape this committee is reconstituted under the new parliament, would sincerely like and be very keen to continue to contribute to the workings of this committee and any questions that we can clarify, any issues we can clarify, and any clarity we can give you on Scotland's railway is always a good opportunity for us. Thank you, Mr. Convener.
Okay, that concludes your opening statement.
Yeah, would you like me to pick up on a few highlights that I would like to pick up, if possible, on a few
Please.
Highlights? So, since we've met, and I'll just pick up on a few of the key items that are really important, have been really important for us to build on the spirit of the things that we discussed at the previous meeting. As you would have seen at Haymarket, for example, which was a clear station for discussion last time round, we are now building a cycle hub that will take the 22 spaces to 90 spaces. The point is not that we're doing that. As we had this really good conversation last time round, it is about working closely with the City of Edinburgh Council and Sustrans to make sure that this is consulted outside of what was called the so-called red line. We're very excited about that, and I think cycling, especially at Haymarket, is really important to fix. Another one would be, as you're probably aware, that we've found a way forward with land securities on the development of the Buchanan Galleries development in Glasgow. So that both programs, both the Egypt program and the renewal of Glasgow Queen Street, as well as the Buchanan Galleries development, can fit into a delivery timeline over the next couple of years. That was also a big development in terms of thinking across the so-called red line and working collaboratively with SPT, Glasgow City Council, as well as with Network Rail Projects and with Land Securities. We've created, on the Aberdeen to Inverness line, for example, we've created what we call informed groups, as that is a major enhancement of the Aberdeen to Inverness line. There is a huge focus on engaging local communities and to make sure that we have lots of visibility and lots of clarity to local communities in terms of our programs, as well as our objectives. Also engages with access groups and it's very useful. Fourth important thing is, as you know, we've opened the north ramp at Waverley for cyclists. That's working reasonably well. We still every now and again have a delivery van parked blocking the cycling route, but for cyclists this is a big step forward and it's great for the development of cycling access to our major stations. Gateway, Edinburgh Gateway, is a fantastic new station that you'll see on your way to the airport, close to Gogar, and it's fantastic for us as a new connection point, multimodal connection point for travelling around the Edinburgh area. And that was also succeeded to get quite a lot of access groups as well as quite a lot of different groups, such as the City of Edinburgh Council, engaged with Network Rail to make sure that we have a development that is constructive and that meets the requirements of all stakeholders. And I think that's perhaps the refrain, the message of what we have done since we've met with the committee last time. A huge focus to make sure that there's significantly more conversation, discussion and clarity between different interest groups where we as a railway interface to the local community. I would like to pick up on one more, and that'll be the taxi rank we are proposing in the New Street car park to develop a taxi rank for Waverley. That'll be a drop-off facility, and a pick-up facility would be in the New Street car park. We're working, again, very closely with the City of Edinburgh Council. And I think that would give us a significantly better taxi facility than what we have at Market Street currently. That was also a consequence of that earlier decision a couple of years ago to summarily move the taxi rank. And I think we've worked very closely with Edinburgh to make sure that we have a better way forward than where the council is currently and where taxi facilities are currently. Perhaps just to close, we have, as a business, as a ScotRail Alliance, we have a massive focus on customers. And customers are the center point of our roadmap and our strategy. I'm very pleased to share with the committee that we scored a 90% score of customers that are satisfied or very satisfied with our services in the autumn 2015 National Rail Passenger Survey. The National Rail Passenger Survey is the definitive survey of customer satisfaction across all train operators. And of all of the big train operators, as in ourselves, with 2,300 plus services that we operate per day, we were one of the operators that scored the best in this passenger survey. That does not mean we've achieved everything we have to achieve. We know there is loads we can do to improve the railway still. We have a huge program going forward, £475 million of investment in our rolling stock fleets would be important to address busy trains, punctuality programs to make sure our punctuality improves even more than what we have improved it this year, and to make sure that our customer satisfaction in the years to come is more than what it is now. So if I could close with that, Mr. Convener.
Very much, Mr. Verster. Perhaps I could kick off just by asking you, you've mentioned the railway interface with the general public and with stakeholders more generally. Can you tell us a little bit about how you've gone about improving that engagement with rail industry stakeholders, particularly with regards to the major train redevelopment projects across the country?
Yes, so if I could sort of divide my answer in two parts. Since we've met last time, we have formed a stakeholder advisory panel and a stakeholder equality panel. These two panels are really important for us. We engage people from all over Scotland and all over the different sectors of life in these stakeholder advisory panels and in the stakeholder equality panel. These two panels are not where business gets done, though. These two panels are places where we can reflect, take stock on whether the strategy of what we're doing with equality groups and access groups, and then in the wider sense with our stakeholders in general, meets the requirements of the railway. So that would be the first answer, and I'm very pleased that we've got that in place, because it's really important for us to not just do tactical stuff, but to also reflect on whether we are strategically keeping in the right on the right track. Then on a tactical basis, every enhancement project, every, as the convener called it, every redevelopment project on the railway is allocated a communications team member. The communications team member facilitates interactions, and I can take Aberdeen to Inverness, and I can take Egypt as two examples. They facilitate interfaces with local communities, with access groups, and the discussions around what needs to be done to support what the local communities require can vary between projects. And these communications members are the facilitators of those of those discussions. So if I pick on if I give you an example on the Waverley platform extension, the Edinburgh Station's accessibility forum was consulted on that, but even more than that, key stakeholders were invited to a meeting in December and to discuss access concerns and access requirements. And I think that becomes less of a thing to do on a program and just part of our basic approach now to all of our programs. And I think that will continue going forward.
Ask you then, since you gave Edinburgh Waverley as an example, it gives me the perfect opportunity to ask you about the progress that's been made there. You mentioned opening the north ramp for cyclists, and I know that has been very much welcomed by cycling organisations. So full marks for that. You say there have been discussions with the Edinburgh Access panel to take on board the needs of disabled people, and you mentioned that that you're looking at the feasibility of a taxi rank at New Street car park entrance, which would be an improvement on existing arrangements. Have you done that as a result of the discussions that you've had with disabled people and people with a visual impairment in particular?
Yes, we have. And with regard to the facilities we have in Colton Road, for example, a direct consequence of the conversations we've had with access or people with reduced mobility, we have added the shelter. We've added a better communications link to our mobility assistance team. And we have taken the considerations of the access groups or groups that deal with people with reduced mobility on board to deal with wayfinding within Waverley as well. So wayfinding have been improved, and I dare say we now regularly invite different disability groups back into Waverley to give us running commentary on what they think needs to be changed still. So it's not even as if it's a once-off event to consult. I know for a fact that my customer experience director met with a group from Max a couple of weeks ago at Waverley again to discuss the changes we've made at Waverley.
A process of continuous dialogue and improvement to meet the needs of your stakeholders, particularly disabled people.
I think so, and I think we'll continue to do that. I can only say that at nearly every occasion when we meet with different groups, we get different information every time, useful information, and every time it allows us to just consider again what our policies are, what our strategies are, and what we can adjust. So this is more than just a meet to hear complaints. This is becoming something that will drive our policies into the future to be more focused on customers.
Certainly, the feedback that we've received as a committee from disabled organisations is that it has been far, since taxis were denied access to Waverley Station, it has been far more difficult for disabled people to have a seamless journey from the taxi to the train and from the train to the taxi. And notwithstanding your commitment to engage in a constructive way with those organisations, they still feel that what we have today is inferior to what previously existed. So what I wanted to ask you was whether there is any way that you would be willing to consider community transport organisations which exist and operate in the city of Edinburgh having access to the station, and whether it would be possible, whether your discussions have looked at the issue of specific disabled organisations and people being able to use taxis on a licensed basis that would allow them to gain access to the station.
Yeah. The challenge for us here in terms of access to the station is as we get closer and closer to the work that we're going to do related to Egypt and the platform work close to the south ramp, is that access to the station for vehicles themselves are going to be very, very difficult. So the proposition we have, which is a very strong proposition, is the new street car park. It is a significant improvement for any group of people with reduced mobility. And we are working very closely with the City of Edinburgh Council to get that work started around around June and July. And we have consulted with access, with different disability groups and access groups on what that would be as a solution. And the response has been broadly constructive and positive. And it's a definite improvement on what we have at Market Street currently.
That sounds like a no to me in terms of access to vehicles into the station for disabled
people. For now,
people.
Interim, till we do. Okay. If that's something I can take away, I'll think about
okay.
that. Convener, please, I'll think about that. I'll take that away and come back to
Dave
you.
Dave Stewart has a supplementary on that.
Thank you, Convener. You recall that we took quite a lot of evidence in this, Mr. Verster, and I think myself, along with other colleagues, just were expressing some surprise why vehicles were moved from Waverley. But other stations, such as Aberdeen, have access to cars direct into the station. I mean, is there any particular security reasons why Waverley is being treated differently from other stations across the network? There was some question mark, there were some security issues, but I don't think, Convener, we ever got to the bottom of that particular issue. I know it's probably before your time, but I'd just be interested, apart from the work, I take the point there is some work to be carried out in the station. The point I'm making is, why was a decision made to remove the taxis, for example, from within Waverley? Well, in other stations, that's not the case. Is there any security reason why Waverley has been treated differently?
Waverley was treated like that because of the high footfall and the high risk that vehicles pose to customers and to pedestrians within that area of the two ramps. And if you look at any of the big national stations of similar size to Waverley, over a period of many years, the interaction between road vehicles and pedestrians have been removed. And Waverley has been the last station where that was still the case. And the consequences, as I explained at the last committee meeting, the consequences of an incident that happened where someone tragically lost their life, a pedestrian lost their life due to a vehicle that came, that tried to use the access ramp and then reversed into a pedestrian, triggered a concern around safety. And as I said at the time, I don't necessarily think that that was managed in a structured manner, as it could have been, but it is definitely not in the interests of pedestrians and people on the ground to have vehicles cross the concourse area, because that's in effect what happens. It's just not safe, and we had to make it safer. And there's the difficulty with reintroducing vehicles is it's a balance between the safety risks of some and the facilities and features we provide for people with reduced mobility on the other end of the equation.
To confirm in writing to the committee whether or not the decision to remove vehicles from the station was based on security advice. If there is security advice, I understand you won't be able to share it with us, but whether in fact that decision was based on security advice.
I will be able to confirm that.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on. Adam, you have some questions.
Yes, can I talk about the Borders Railway? And can you give us an update on the performance of the Borders Railway?
Yes, so the Borders Railway, even though I haven't got the statistics with me at this particular moment now, but the Borders punctuality performance have improved systematically over the last couple of months. At the point of introduction, I dare say there was a period of which we expected sort of latent demand or continued interest in the newness of the railway to drive customer numbers. We strengthened trains accordingly. We strengthened weekday trains that we counted peak numbers of passengers on. And we also strengthen trains on Saturdays and Sundays. On Sundays now, we run strengthened trains throughout the day because it's that popular and because it's an hourly service. So what I think I indicated to the committee last time around is that with the new railway, there's quite a lot of newness that needs to find its way to business as usual. Conductors need to understand how the route works. Drivers need to understand how the route works. And very often, our customer base also have to understand how some of the gadgets work, you know, how ticket vending machines work, how doors operate, and doors don't open automatically like on the underground, that type of thing. And it's surprising how many little kinks there are to iron out during that period. All of those have a potential impact on the service. The service pattern is still really tight. Because it's a single line railway, anything that is a failure of a train in a critical location has all of the potential to disrupt the service significantly thereafter. However, we are, from my recollection, performing in the high 80s, considering that our punctuality performance for ScotRail now is around 90.8%. We expect to close this year at 90.8%. We had a opening performance on the franchise of 90.3%, so we're roughly 0.5% better in punctuality, and Borders is contributing to that as well. So the performance is where we expect it to be. Now, I'm very keen to continue to strengthen the Borders fleets. In the next 3 years, as you probably know, we're adding around 180 new coaches and new vehicles to our fleet. Currently, we have a fleet roughly of 800 carriages. We're going to add 180 carriages. We have this £475 million train renewal program, which is just the biggest rolling stock program that Scotland's Railway has ever seen. And it's a fantastic program. And as we buy over the next 3 years, as we buy new rolling stock and deploy those across the network, we will continue to strengthen services in places such as Fife as well as the Borders.
Okay, there have been concerns expressed about the Class 158 rolling stock that's currently in use in the Borders Railway, specifically that more 4 or 6 car services should be run and refurbishment should be carried out as a matter of urgency. You recognise that, do you?
We do. And the Class 158 programme is a refurbishment programme that is ongoing. So part of our £475 million investment is to refurbish quite a number of different fleets. And the Class 158 program is definitely part of that. Mr. Ingram, the challenge for us is time, in the sense that the capacity of the companies that provide train refurbishment facilities for us is X. And if we try and put 3 or 4 units at a time in to get the refurbishment done as quickly as possible, then we run short of units to run the daily service. So we try to get that trade-off right. And so we've agreed a program for the refurbishment of the Class 158 fleet with Transport Scotland, which sort of reflects the practicalities of what we can achieve. I must agree with you, the 158 fleet must, and the 156 fleet as well, both is in need of that critical refurbishment to give it a more modern look and feel. And I dare say, when you look at the refurbished units that have come out, like Unit 701, it's a fantastic product.
The other question I had was, this will be returned to no doubt by others, cycle carrying capacity. Has anything been done on the Borders Railway to expand cycle carrying capacity?
So, when we look at cycling, I'd like to sort of just create context for the discussion around cycling. When I talk to customers, we always have different needs expressed by the customers. Majority of our customers are keen for seats on trains. So we have a trade-off decision to make between what space we allow for seating and what space we allow for cycling. So what we have on the refurbished Class 158 product is two designated cycling spaces. But we have also agreed with the Department for Transport Accessibility Committee, who is the holder of the keys on all things accessibility-wise, that we can take the second wheelchair space on the Class 158s and we can demarcate that area for use for cyclists, cycling spaces as well. And that's on a single two-car. So I know there's been lots of letters and correspondence and questions in Parliament about what availability there'll be for cycling spaces. And sometimes the detail is where the answer lies. So when we have these two additional spaces, so there's the two spaces that will be designated and an additional two spaces in the wheelchair area, it can only be operated like that if, as long as we, as ScotRail, ensures that the wheelchair area gets priority should there be a wheelchair user that wants to use that space. And in those circumstances, to just be really practical about it and to be really honest about it, our staff is going to find a way to move those two bicycles and put them on another place on the train. And I see that we are going to continue to provide the facility to move bicycles on all of our fleets. If I can just for a moment give you a sense of, on our Class 385 fleet, which is the new fleet that's coming in, we've got two designated bike spaces. We've got a further two designated bike and cycling spaces in the universal access toilet area where there are flip-up seats. And then we've got two more spaces in the luggage area for folding bicycles. So our commitment to support cyclists is definitely there. But I just want to make a really big point on cycling. We are much, much, much more interested in developing cycling at stations and as a facility to get to our railway. In the end, our trains are not really aimed at moving bicycles. So we are putting 3,500 cycling spaces in the next three and a half years into our stations. And that covers a multitude of stations that also includes putting in Glasgow, in Edinburgh, as well as in Stirling, very big cycle points that allow a provider of cycling services to overall maintain, resell second-hand bicycles and the like. So we are much more keen to support cycling as an active mode of travel that comes to our railway rather than comes on our trains. But in order to account for those people, and some cyclists, when they talk to me, say, yeah, but I cycle to the railway, I cycle to a station, I get on a train, and I cycle at the other end as well. Do you want to buy two bicycles? I said, well, it would be nice if you could. Yeah, but we have this very difficult balance. And I can guarantee you that if I ask a broad spectrum of my customers, what should we do? Should we have two more seats or should we have two more cycling spaces? The vote would probably go to seats.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, Alex.
Thank you, convener. Scotland has a wonderful climate and a wide range of ways in which the weather can affect the rail network. This winter has been no different. I wondered if you could take us through some of the reasons for the closures and the underlying causes this winter.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. So our railway is very exposed to environmental impacts. And if I pick up on two of the biggest concerns and risks that we are facing, and I'll use a few examples, then the two biggest concerns would be landslips, and on the one hand, and scour. Now, scour is a phenomenon whereby the foundations of bridges are endangered due to significantly increased levels of water flow, both level and rate. And landslips are caused by repetitive, long-duration saturation of the soil levels that over time causes embankments to be unstable. So those are two major risks for us. The risk of embankments are that something happens in the night, first train out, hits a slurry, a mud slurry on the track and derails. Scour obviously poses massive risk to bridge structures. So if I can use scour as an example and perhaps talk about Lamington. Lamington was just huge for us in terms of its impact and in terms of the phenomenon itself. So give you a rough example, and the committee a rough indicator of the severity of weather and how it affects us. In the Clyde at Lamington, the water level is typically 0.7, on average, 0.7 of a meter deep. And that is on averages. On the 31st of December, when we started to see the damage at Lamington, it was 3 meters deep. And just give you a sense of what that means is if you think of where the deck of the viaduct or the bridge structure is, the water was right underneath the deck level. Now, what that does is it causes quite a lot of flows because of that huge volume of water that is more intense and faster the deeper down the structure you go, the deeper down the river you go. And that undermined the one pier's foundations at Lamington. And it was a big concern for us. Now, what we have and what we have now deployed to Lamington as well, and what we have with structures such as Dalgais in the Pitlochry area, which often affects the Highland Main Line, unfortunately, is a practice whereby when the water level gets above a certain marker, and we call it the amber marker, then we caution trains to drive slowly and to be on the lookout for anything abnormal. When it goes above a red marker level, we close the line. We close the line, close the structure, because we prioritize, there is no debate. We prioritize the safety of the structure and the safety of the railway. Over the December-January period, Dalgais was affected multiple times, and it really affected the service on the Highland Main Line significantly. And so did flooding on away from Dalgais itself, but on the rest of the Highland Main Line as well. We had a washout in a different part of that line. So yes, the amount of water that we are seeing, to put it bluntly, the amount of water and the level of water fall that we are getting and rainfall we are getting in Scotland in this last couple of years is steadily increasing, and it's becoming a real challenge for us to figure out what do we need to do fundamentally different in our renewals plans and in our and in our planning of strengthening of structures as well as the strengthening of embankments and cuttings to make us more robust in our defense against these weather phenomena. Now, we have operational means to respond to severe weather. And the operational means are things like when we get extraordinary high gusts of winds, for example, which is another weather phenomenon, then we close part of our electric network. If we get certain rainfall levels within certain periods, then we send teams out to go and observe what landslip risk areas are doing. And we therefore have as many defensive operational measures as we can have in defense of severe weather. However, Lamington has brought back a reality to us that we need to think of how we invest in more scour-resistant techniques, for example, and a different renewals programme to make our structures more robust.
Certainly aware of the issue about high rainfall. I was on a train on the East Coast Main Line between Montrose and Lawrencekirk that on a day when the railway was subsequently closed, the train I was on had to slow to walk and pace and go through deep water as the cuttings filled with the rain. But you explained the action you're taking in the short to medium term, but is there a long-term strategy that can be taken with the railways to try and make them more robust against the prevailing weather conditions?
So there is. And the long-term strategy that has been put forward by Network Rail was considered a good strategy at the time, secured a portion of funds over the control period. I can't give you the exact number currently, but I figure around 240 million comes to mind across the country. And there is a need for us to take that basic long-term strategy and continue to evolve it to deal with more of the scenarios that we are seeing. And if I put that into practical words, if I look at my operational strategy with landslips, I need to translate what I do currently by sending teams of people out to go and look at high-risk landslip sites to something that uses telemetry and electronic measurement. Sort of displacement of soil levels must trigger an alarm that just gets sent back to our control. That requires investment, and that's the type of thing that I think is becoming more and more essential for us to put into that long-term strategy. In our planning now for control period 6, which is for the control period from April 29 onwards, we are putting exactly that type of investment proposals to the funders, which in this case would be DfT and Transport Scotland, and that would be part of our long-term strategy.
The two things I've seen done on the railway to deal with the embankment problem is reinforcing with cages full of crushed rock, and the more complex is reducing the angles of embankments. Is that the type of work which will continue?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because the angles of embankments is generally a good indicator of something that can be done. But it depends very, very often about what's in that soil on the embankment. And you can have a fairly steep angle, but if it is a good composition and a strong composition, strongly supported by structural supports, then that embankment could be perfectly fine as it is. It is sometimes the less obvious embankments that has got rubbish over many years that have collected there, and it's not as firm in its constitution, that poses the risk. Now, my route asset manager for earthworks have got a map and a plan of each sort of length along the railway in terms of what its condition is, what its composition of material is, and what the risk is that it poses. And we look at those earthworks on a rolling program, control period after control period, to renew that and to get that into a better condition. So we have plans for that. However, your question is still very pertinent. The plans need to be given a different shape and need to, in some cases, be sped up in order to make us more robust for severe weather.
Mike.
Thank you, Convener. I was pleased to hear of the progress with Egypt that you gave in your opening statement, and I just wondered if you're confident that the service changes planned for the closure of Queen Street, the high-level station at Queen Street, will be able to meet the demands whilst minimising delays.
Yes. Thank you, Ms. McKenzie. So I'm very pleased that you said, when you said the closure of Queen Street, you added the high level.
Yeah.
Because one of the very important messages we're trying very hard to get out to our customer base into Scotland is that Queen Street is not closing. We're open for business, and our whole communications campaign is about keeping you moving, and that's our banner. And so, yes, we have a really big challenge with a new revised timetable. Can I give you a snapshot? So any weekday, I move around 39,000 customers into the high level. Around 5,200 of them come in at the in the peak. It's around 366 trains. So that's the capacity. And by the way, on any day when I move 39,000 customers, I have capacity running through the high level of 75,000 seats. So roughly, you know, and that takes the off-peak also into consideration, roughly we have one out of every two seats occupied on a full day service pattern. So our revised timetable is tough, and it's tight. What we are doing is, and just if we're talking percentages, around 20% of the people that travel into Queen Street High Level are traveling end-to-end from Edinburgh to Glasgow. So they're not intermediate station pickups, but they are end-to-end. So we've got a very strong campaign to target that 20% and to convince them to use the Airdrie to Bathgate services or the service via shots. So in a sweep, we're shifting 20% of that capacity that went into the high level onto Airdrie to Bathgate, four trains per hour, or shots, two trains per hour. Then the remainder, 65% of the remaining capacity, which then brings us to 85%, 65% of the remaining capacity, we are redirecting through the low level. And so the low level now becomes really, really busy. And those are services from Falkirk High, Linlithgow, and the existing services, the Helenspress, the Mill Guys that continue to run through the station, are all in that, all going through the low level and provides that service pattern for us. Now, that service is going to be very dependent on punctual joining of customers on the train and alighting of customers on the train. So what we've set up around Queen Street, both platforms at the low level, both platforms 8 and 9, is a systematic holding pattern whereby we bring people by train size down to the lower level, queue them up, and help them to get onto the train that then departs. So we are doing everything we can to what's called the dwell time, to minimize that dwell time and to minimize the transition of people onto and off the train. And the timetable is tight. It's going to be very tight. And we spent hours with our teams figuring out what we should do here. There is just no way I cannot provide the service that is necessary for our customers. We have to provide that service for our customers. So we have to find a way to make that tight timetable work. And my teams have, and what we have done, and I wish I can show the committee some of this in real life, but what we have done between Network Rail and Enhancement Projects, or the IP team, or Infrastructure Projects team, which is not part of the Alliance, but the Alliance as well, my own Network Rail infrastructure people, my own train operating company people, we've done what we call readiness reviews, where we've gone through iteratively through different levels of detail to figure out what can we do better to make sure it works on the day. And only yesterday I visited my teams at Queen Street, and they've taken one whole room at Queen Street Station, and they've put all of the scenarios on the walls, and that they use to brief our employees and our people on how to respond and where should everyone stand at what, but in the peak, this is how we do the peak, this is where you should stand, this is what you should do, and this is what you do in the off-peak. And they've got role descriptions, or what's called role simplifiers, that says what everyone needs to do. So yeah, your question is very pertinent. It's going to be challenging. We've got plans. I expect that in the first week and a half, we're going to learn more than what we thought we were going to prepare for. And the original plans will probably be a casualty a little bit in parts, and we'll do come up with new plans. But whichever way you look at it, I have to continue to move those numbers of people. And so we are very confident that the Winchborough experience has taught us a lot about helping customers to make decisions on their journey options. And we are reasonably confident that we have all of the bases covered. We will see what happens in this first week. We'll see what areas we may not have covered well, and we'll adjust.
Myself into a bit of a hole in this committee, because on a previous occasion or two I've quoted a bit of poetry, and the line that springs to mind is one from Robert Burns. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but it's the line that says the best laid plans of mice and men gang after glee. And so my next question really is, I'm absolutely, you know, I can see that you've given this very serious thought indeed. But have you retained a bit of flexibility so that, you know, if you find the plans have maybe not quite got it right, do you have some spare capacity that you can play with? Do you have a degree of flexibility?
I don't.
You don't?
Don't. Right. There is no spare capacity. We are, to give you a sense of this, I'm hiring in crews from other train operators and freight operators to help me with transferring some of the services from Aberdeen and Inverness into Glasgow Central. And we haven't got spare capacity. We haven't. It's all out. And it's going to be all out for this 20-week period. And it's going to be a huge effort from our side. And we have to find ways to create the robustness which spare capacity could have given us. Let me give you an example. With the way that I'm cycling rolling stock and services through areas from Belgrove through to Hindland, if I have a train failure there, the plan is dead. The daily service plan is dead. And that's just the way the network is. So we have put more train fitters that normally work on trains in the depots, we'll put on the stations to, if there's a train that shows a hiccup, that we can get that train fitter on the train to see if it can diagnose the problem and fix it and get it to run. So we don't have to send a fitter to site. I'll have infrastructure engineers that will look after the signaling system in those areas. And if there's anything there that gives a hiccup, they'll be on hand. So we're deploying people that would typically do other duties to be there to give us a robust service on the day. So no, I'll be very honest. The plan is tight, and it's going to be tough. But we're very excited about it, because to be honest, it's a once in 50 years, and we just have to fix that tunnel. It's a once in 50 years event, so we have to just do it.
Yeah, and so. You know, my next question would be really about this 20-week closure period. I mean, are you confident that the works can be completed within that period? And if not, do you have some contingencies for, you know, an extended period of construction?
So, yes, the work in the tunnel becomes something that's more manageable and better understood than sort of the call it the vagaries of what can happen on an operating railway during the 20-week blockade. And I'm very confident in the Network Rail Infrastructure Projects IP team. I've suggested to them some time ago that they must do some trial working. And what they did very successfully is, over the Christmas period, when services were down, they went into the tunnel and they experimented with their technique to remove the concrete from the tunnel, to break it up. And as you know, there are thousands of tons of concrete that must be moved, and I've got the stat or the number around here somewhere. But for the 1,800 meters of slab that must be removed, they have to have a technique that they can time, and say, yep, if I'm going to do so many drills over here, so many holes I'm going to drill, and then I'm going to break the concrete out and I'm going to ship it out, it's going to take me so many hours, therefore, that's how long it's going to take me. They did that in December. And it gave them a high degree of confidence that they will deliver that. You can imagine, I know how critical it is that we deliver that on time. And you can imagine how imagine how nervous we all are about the scope of it, because quite a lot of it's unknown. When you dig in one part of the tunnel, you can get to another part of the tunnel and you can encounter different rock formations and stuff like that. So there is a large part of the work that has a known nature to it that we can plan for and understand. We understand we're fitting the same slab track as we fit in Winchborough. And when we did Winchborough, we learned lessons about how to fit the slab, and the guys have got that knowledge in hand. But there's still a proportion of uncertainty that we have in that 20-week program. And so that's also going to be exciting. We're going to have to deal with it as the challenges emerge.
Keep my fingers crossed. My final question really is just about, we know that there are, there's a wider redevelopment of Queen Street plan. Could you, just give outline that for us and how things are going with that?
Yes. So, this is the bit I referred to right in the beginning. We had a very tough situation about 6 months ago, where it appeared as if the Buchanan Galleries development and the redevelopment of the station was going to be sort of mutually exclusive rather than mutually inclusive and wouldn't be able to be completed at the same time. Now, it's really, really important, and I must be really honest with you, that it's this committee has played its role in helping organizations to figure out what they should be doing in the community. The railway typically would have focused on, we have to build a new station, so can everyone just get out of the way, we're going to build a new station. So I think we're now in a better place because we now think differently. Queen Street Station is not about the railway. Queen Street Station is about Glasgow. And we've worked very closely with the Glasgow City Council and with Anne-Marie and her team, and with SPT, Gordon and his team, and I'm very pleased to say that we have a way forward whereby we can accommodate the development of the station itself as well as the Buchanan Street Galleries development. And this is an ongoing discussion with Land Securities to make sure that we achieve both. And I can say we're now in the process on, there's a south cutting part where we've very close to concluding a deal with Land Securities that will allow some of the development to start and to proceed. So if that was part of your question, I can just say that that part has come together much better than where it was 6 months ago, where I think there was sort of heads banging together in terms of the two developments themselves. But if I talk more about the station itself, It's one of these things that we can do more of to show committees like this about what it is we're planning. And it is just a fantastic change to the station with quite a lot of glass frontage that will change the nature, we think, of how George Square is perceived and how George Square is actually sort of drawn into the station itself. The really exciting bit about it is we will now, during the blockade that starts on the 20th, we'll start to lengthen the platforms to the 7 and 8 car lengths that we need. And therefore, we'll have that huge increase in capacity available in Queen Street itself. The biggest challenge for us that comes with the phasing of works for the Queen Street Station redevelopment is to provide a retail offer that is acceptable for a station of that size. Now, if we could have succeeded to get Buchanan Galleries and the Queen Street development to integrate perfectly, we would have had a Buchanan Street quality and class of retail right at station level. So because these are now going to be slightly shifted in time, we'll probably not have that. And we are working with TS, Transport Scotland, to put a retail facilities in the station that is sufficient for the commuters that will use Queen Street. And perhaps if I just leave a thought with you, and because this will get a lot of consultation in public and this will get a lot of discussion. If you think of Glasgow Central, then Glasgow Central feels like a destination station, and the retail facilities we've got there is pretty superb. But if you think of Queen Street, then sort of most of the super attractive retail around it is actually already outside of the station. So it's perhaps a slightly different retail proposition, but it still needs to meet the needs of our people. But it probably doesn't have to be the same as we have in Central. So we feel very excited about what Queen Street Station would look like.
Thank you very much for such comprehensive answers. I hope all these projects go well.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I ask you about the new Hitachi electric trains? Obviously, I'm sure as many members of the committee, I'm very excited by the prospects of these trains coming online. And clearly, with the interaction with climate change, I think it's vitally important that we do look at higher targets for electric trains. A couple of points, and Mr. Ingram has stolen my thunder, not for the first time, on capacity issues. There is some issues around the ability to carry bikes on these trains. I take your point, the earlier points you made on this, but could you just touch on that first? And I've got some other follow-on points to do with the Hitachi AT200s.
Yeah. You'd like me to pick up on the cycling?
Sure.
So on the cycling, the class 385s, so the AT200s was sort of the original Hitachi codification. So it'll be class 385s going forward. So when I talk about class 385s, just put that into the same bracket as 80-200s. It's the same thing. So on the class 385, we'll have two clearly designated cycling spaces. In the area of the universal access toilet, we'll have space for another two cycling spaces, and those would not be in the similar place as I've explained the 158s to be. That those would be in an area where there are flip-up seats, so that wouldn't be subject to a priority of another user. So that's two additional spaces, and then for folding bicycles in the luggage rack area, in the luggage space area, a further two fold-up cycles would be able to be accommodated. And that is per unit. And so that feels like a pretty reasonable coverage of cycling.
So compared with your more traditional rolling stock, you're in fact saying there's an enhancement and ability to carry bikes and trains.
More, right. Yeah. So take the Class 380. So the Class 380, which is the Siemens DeZero product, that, as you know, operates very widely in Strathclyde area as well as through to Edinburgh itself. You'd have two designated spaces, and the other two spaces we use in a similar area to the wheelchair area, but the restriction there is we haven't got a derogation like we have for the 158s. So when the law changes and insists that wheelchair spaces are used for wheelchairs only, we wouldn't be able to put bicycles in that area. So even if we could, it is still on the class 385s, we'll be able to take two more folding bicycles than...
That's positive news. I appreciate that. Could I just touch very briefly, because time is tight, Convener, on an industrial relations issue? I understand from the relevant trade unions that there's an unofficial overtime ban about plans to downgrade conductors on the new electric trains. Can you update us on that? Is that correct? And if so, can you advise us, is there plans to downgrade conductors on the new electric trains?
So can I be really absolutely clear on this? So we don't have any plans to downgrade conductors, to use that language at all. Conductors play an immensely important safety role for us on our railway. What we have, in simple terms, is a conductor, when used as a conductor on a train, closes the doors and dispatches a train. Now, in the Strathclyde area, for decades now, we've not used that practice. We've used the practice with a ticket examiner on a train and a driver that controls the doors and dispatches the train. So there's a safe working method that we use in the Strathclyde area that can be used. As long as you have two people on a train, you still have a safe product. And what we have done with our conductor colleagues is we've engaged them in a proposal whereby we are guaranteeing that we will use conductors on the Falkirk line between Edinburgh and Glasgow, and that we will continue to use conductors on all of our diesel services. And so what could be potentially seen as having less conductors on our railway is not the case. We are developing our service proposals that will go with Aberdeen to Inverness services in the future. And with our fleet plans, as well as our network plans that we have, if we can engage our conductor community to work on Sundays as part of the working week with us, then we can guarantee the same number of conductors that we employ currently. So in terms of an IR issue, how did we approach this? Instead of working out a proposal and putting it to our trade unions, what we have done is we've worked with a number of the different local teams, and we have discussed with them what proposals could work for them. We've discussed an implicit memorandum of understanding, and we have published this week what we call a fact sheet of roughly what our proposals are. Now, I've seen in the press that there are references made to what you refer to as an informal overtime ban. I can't really comment on that. It's up to individuals where they personally decide they will not work overtime, don't want to work overtime. Overtime is not something that they are committed to work in any case. I'm in a place where I am extremely positive about what we have as an opportunity here for conductors to still have roles in our massively important roles in our business. But we will now go through a process of consultation with our unions on the proposals, and hopefully we'll get an agreement in the coming weeks.
First, I don't have time to pursue that these points, but perhaps you could keep the committee up to date with that particular issue. Can I just move on to the draft Scottish route study? I think that was published in December. Could you explain what the outcomes of that exercise has been?
So the route study is based on what we expect the railways' impact and growth would be in the next 25 years. And you would have seen there that we expect traffic increasing by around 114% in Edinburgh, around 108% in Glasgow, and Aberdeen up to 151% over the next 25 years. Now, what the route study does, the route study propositions options. And the options are propositioned for consultation by communities, by interest groups, and to be honest, by all stakeholders in Scotland. And there's a consultation process which I think completes by the end of March. And once that consultation process has been completed and feedback has been received, that gets packaged up and gets discussed with the funders. The funders, Transport Scotland, will make a decision on which of those opportunities are the highest priorities and where to steer the investment for the next couple of control periods. So in brief, that's what the route study tries to do.
Convener, can I just raise a parochial Hans Nylens issue, which is important to me? I had some correspondence from Mr. Richard Arden, who's very interested in rail issues. And what he said, and I'm quoting loosely, he said it was impossible to respond properly to the Scottish Route Study because we've not been told what Highland Mainline enhancements are being proposed by Control Period 5. i.e. by March 2019. Could you respond to that issue?
Yeah. That's a really interesting point. So, just this is such a the Highland Main Line is such a good example of why what we're doing in Scotland is so much different to what we're doing in the rest of the UK. I'll explain what I'm saying. So, Highland Main Line was planned to have a couple of interventions on it to achieve an output, and the output was roughly a 10-minute improvement in journey time. But that was proposed by a route study and by Network Rail a couple of years ago. So there's that proposal. When Abellio ScotRail secured the franchise, Abellio ScotRail said, we want to run high-speed trains. The assumption in the original proposal for the Highland Main Line was class 170s. I dare say if you consider anyone that travels on those routes, a class 170 is more commuter product than a long-distance product. And so what's beautiful about what we're doing in Scotland as an alliance is we bring the two worlds together and said, oh, hang on. If we're going to run HST trains, do we really need to spend that same amount of money on the Highland Main Line with those same options? Or can we do something different? Because you have a different train, different speed, different acceleration, and we are now publishing around the end of April our Grip 3 stage, which is the sort of the concept design of where the interventions on the Highland Main Line needs to be. So from the point of Abellio winning the franchise, the Network Rail and design teams had to look for a different solution. So the commentary that you got from your reader is accurate. Because we now know that the two interventions we'll have will be at Aviemore and Pitlochry and will not be at the original locations that was in the original plan, because the rolling stock allows us to intervene in different places with a simpler manner and a simpler solution. So it's a very valid comment, but when we through this year, in the next couple of months, when our proposals for the Highland Main Line are published, your reader or the person that corresponded to you on that would have a better sense of where we're going to invest and would then be able to fit that into the understanding of the route study itself.
Certainly that route. I think a very important objective is to reduce journey times, particularly going south. You'll know from my parliamentary questions that the actual average time improvement has actually been 1 minute going south, if you take away one of the Sunday journeys, and that's what I got back, rather than the 18 minutes. But again, I don't have time to pursue you on that issue, but I'm sure that's something you'll be very aware of in terms of future improvements.
Can I ask about the draft Scotland route study before you move on, David?
That's what, yeah.
Have you finished with the draft route?
Yes.
One of the other propositions in that consultation, of course, is a proposal to electrify and enhance the Edinburgh Suburban Railway. And you'll know that that's an issue that I'm particularly interested in. But that specific proposal is for existing freight traffic and the diversion of passenger routes onto that route. My question for you would be, given the renewed interest that there is in reinstating the former Edinburgh South Suburban Railway for passenger use, albeit that is a very early stage, we don't yet have a feasibility study that would provide the green light for that. If that work was to be included in the next control period up until 2024, would that work future-proof the route for possible future passenger use?
I think electrification, wherever it's deployed, future-proofs partially or fully whatever developments come afterwards. And when you think of a tram-train solution, tram-train solutions are typically electrified solutions because you don't want to run trams in city centres with diesel engines. I mean, those days are long, long past. So in terms of just the structured logic of your question is accurate, definitely accurate, is that electrification on the South Suburban route would be for freight as well as to help with diversionary flows for any disruption on the western side of Waverley. And once that is installed, it can be installed in a way that can make provision for a future extension of a tram train solution. And tram train solutions must be on the cards for so many big cities in the UK. And it presents a real practicable solution to get stations and footfall off the heavy rail network. So yes, I think it could be. The business case is the key, though, isn't it? The business case for opening sub-suburban line for passenger transport is the key, and that must be agreed with Transport Scotland first.
I think I'm right in saying that prior to your role with the ScotRail Alliance, you were involved in the development of the first ever UK train tram.
I was.
In Sheffield, and I learned that when I visited Sheffield recently to learn more about that particular project. So I think my final question to you on this would be, were there to be a feasibility study, would the ScotRail Alliance stand ready and willing to make their expertise available to that study in order to take this work forward?
Yes. So the work would predominantly be led by the Network Rail Infrastructure Projects team, who's not part of the Alliance, but who we will act as client for on behalf of TS. So, and we will definitely steer that. Now, Sheffield had its challenges, and there are many lessons learned from Sheffield, and I think the lessons learned from Sheffield would help us to not repeat some of the issues that occurred there.
Thank you. David, do you have a final question?
Yes, thank you, Convener. My final question is, what involvement has the ScotRail Alliance had with the Shaw Review, which, as you know, is the UK government review looking at the future shape and financing of Network Rail?
So I participated in the review, and one or two members of my team participated in the review as well. And so we met with Nicholas Shaw on an individual basis. I met with Nicholas Shaw on an individual basis, as well as in a working group context. And I dare say there was quite a lot of interest in what we're doing in Scotland. This whole way of working in Scotland, where we have the Network Rail route team that does maintenance and operation of the railway paired up in an alliance with Abellio ScotRail franchise, two different legal entities, two different sets of accountabilities, but one management team and an aligned strategy to deliver what's right for both businesses is just common sense. And I, you know, obviously the Shaw report will be published in a couple of weeks' time. What I can say is that all of these reports have one thing in common, and that is that the railway industry needs to focus on probably three important things, and those three important things are customers, customers, and customers. And if we get those three important things right, then quite a lot of what happens behind the scenes will align itself properly and will just deliver a growing railway going forward.
I mean, we obviously can't predict what's going to happen in the Shaw Review, but we can speculate, as politicians like to do, that could, for example, be a full privatisation of Network Rail. You've obviously got a very close alliance in the current setup you have. How would that affect your operation if that was the recommendation of the Shaw Review, and was that something accepted by the UK government?
So, without having a view on whether privatisation or not privatisation of parts of Network Rail is right or wrong, I actually don't see that decision between privatisation and non-privatisation as the core issue facing the railway. I see the core issue facing the railway as the need for a clearer, perhaps simpler, but stronger in some areas, regulating function. The regulator must have a clearer role. That's probably going to be a different role to what it has today. And I see an unambiguous alignment of objectives to focus on customer issues at the front end of the industry. And neither of those two really have an impact or is affected by how you decide whether you privatize the asset base or not. So for us as a alliance, What decision is made on Network Rail's structure or whether private finance is invited in to own parts of Network Rail is neither here nor there. For us, the focus is simply to take the asset base we've got, to take the operational methods we've got, and to maximise the benefits for the customer.
So you're absolutely confident, irrespective of the outcome of the Shell review and irrespective of what is accepted by the UK government, this will not have an impact on the day-to-day working in the Alliance?
Not the way that my team and myself are running our business. No. We run our business with whatever assets we've got, whatever policies we've got, whatever operations we've got, we run it with a focus on what are the objectives that the Scottish Government has set for us. So that's it. We make our decisions based on each of those objectives the Scottish Government has set for us, and we focus on delivering that.
And you've given... Right, okay. With that telling off, I will leave the question there. Thank you. Okay.
Good morning, Mr. Verster. I've got a few areas, three areas to cover with you. The first one is in the area of safety. Now, we know that we do have a good safety record in the UK railways, but a few years ago, I was lucky enough to attend an event hosted by the Scottish Youth Theatre, where ScotRail had been delivering a series of workshops to primary 5 and 6 children, particularly in the areas of electrification on the line. I was really impressed with the skills that were being taught to the young people and that safety message. So I was just wondering if you're doing anything like that now or intend to do anything in the future.
Yes. Yes, we've got a very active programme that includes a rota of visits to schools. We've got a very active programme with level crossings, where our level crossing managers engage with local communities about level crossing safety. And around the developments of our electrification programs, such as Edinburgh to Glasgow, we have very active engagement with local communities on what the risks are of the new railway. Because electrification brings two big threats: a risk relative to electricity, as well as a risk relative to quiet trains. You know, trains are quieter, electric trains, you can't hear the train coming, and therefore footpath crossings, not even level crossings across the railway, can become very unsafe. So absolutely, part of our community engagement program is extensive engagement across the community on those topics.
If I could move on to the area of overcrowding on the trains presently, and you've already discussed the plans for 2017 and the new stock, but I just wondered, given the growth in passenger numbers, which is to be welcomed, but how are you ensuring particularly people with young children or with a disability are getting access to trains that are in the overcrowded status with, as reported in the recent 2014 ScotRail statistics in this area?
So we have trains that are busy. There's no doubt about it. We have trains that are busy, and some trains will be less busy as we start to roll out our new fleets. The new fleets can't come quickly enough. So we've put a lot of effort this year to finalize contracts to get our HST fleet in and to get the Class 385 fleets deployed. If I can for a moment just explain this. I started something in our business which I'm encouraging my leaders to do more of. Once or twice a week, I go on a train and I go on trains all week. I travel trains morning and evening. But once or twice a week, I go on a train and I announce myself to the customers. I say, I'm Phil Verster, I'm the managing director. I'm walking down the train. Please tell me everything you want to tell me about what's wrong and what's right and whatever. And it's amazing. I was doing it yesterday again. And yesterday morning, I traveled to Haymarket and from Queen Street. And do you know that 99% of the comments about our staff and how our staff help people, help children, help people with reduced mobility, is extremely, extremely positive. Our staff are fantastic. They don't need to be invited. They don't need to be managed by a process or to be told what to do. Our staff have just this natural inclination to help people on the railway. So I'm very confident that whatever the circumstances are that are posed to our staff and our employees and our people, that they will respond and deal with the demands of the day. And it's my very strong impression that we are meeting those requirements currently.
Right, thank you for that reassurance, and I'm sure if I'm lucky enough to be returned after the election, I'll look forward to dropping my emails with the complaints about overcrowding as this gets rolled out. One of the unintended consequences of the Fourth Road Bridge closure was an increased popularity in the route between Fife and Edinburgh. Given that the increased numbers which seem to be maintaining on this route, have you given any thought as to how you might improve parking at the stations and the opportunity for people to go from car to train in Edinburgh in these areas?
Yeah, parking is one of those areas where we need to get so much support from local councils. And parking around the railway is not always fully within our gift in terms of either land or access for parking. And it's sort of parking becomes part of the road and the transport strategy for the local council. And there are sort of lots of dimensions to it, which makes it sort of more of a joint issue and much less of a railway issue. I can unambiguously say the more parking we have at stations, the better. And we encourage local councils to work with us. And we, as part of our franchise, are delivering parking, more parking facilities in many places across the network during the next 3 or 4 years. So to develop parking in key nodes has been a commitment that we've signed up to and that we're working very intensely on with local councils. But you're right, there are so many stations out there where parking would benefit the use of the railway. What we do is we pick up from feedback we get from local communities and we feed that back to local councils. We formed what we call an economic development unit, which is a team of people that try to do everything in their power to get councils to invest in parking where it would benefit those local communities. We haven't got the funds nor the property to do all of that ourselves, so it has to be a joint solution.
Thank you for that. If I could just finally ask about train and station standards. During the period between July and September 2015, ScotRail were fined £265,282 for failing to meet the service standards, measuring quality of the trains and stations. And the areas of concern included the toilet facilities, graffiti, passenger information displays, and the seat reservation system. What are you doing to address these service level benchmarks and move towards a better service?
Thank you very much for that question. It's a very good one. Cards on the table. The scheme that we have that those penalties come from is called Squire. It is a immensely powerful scheme. So a target for us to achieve zero fine is around 94% performance on the scheme. Take a guess what we achieve. Around 91-92%. So we're 3 percentage points short, and sometimes, depends on the schedules you're in, that depends on what the fines are. And some of the fines are really tough. You know, if someone doesn't arrive to open a booking office in time, it's curtains for us, and it's a big fine. But it's reasonable. So I can honestly say the Squire system is driving performance, which is manifesting itself in our NRPS score of 90%. I think the quality of our trains, inside, outside, the quality of our stations, the quality of service of our staff is just fantastic. And Squire has made a major contribution to that. So I know that the 260,000 that you talk about becomes the headline, but there is a much more important headline, is that Squire is super powerful to drive customer service quality. And we put everything in place to catch problems and to reduce that payment. Things like if an induction loop system that helps people that are hard of hearing to hear what someone's saying, if those need to be tested regularly, if one of those fail, it as quickly as possible needs to be replaced. So all of these little niggly things becomes a focus for our service quality drive, and it becomes really important to our customers. So I think it's massively good. It's perhaps just useful to make one observation that is very, very positive in terms of how Transport Scotland is approaching this whole Squire scheme, is that whatever payments we make gets reinvested into the railway for the benefit of customers. So I can assure you, as an alliance, that figure that you see in the penalty doesn't mean we are neglecting or ignoring it. If we neglected and ignored it, it would be a ginormous amount of money. We actively engage with it. We think it's a really positive scheme. And what's really positive about it is it gets reinvested into the railway.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Do members have any final questions? Is there anything further you would like to say, Mr. Verster?
No, thank you, Convener. I'm pretty exhausted as it is.
I think on that note, it only remains for me to thank Mr. Verster for attending today's meeting, and also acknowledge that this may well be your last appearance before the committee. In fact, it will undoubtedly be your last appearance before the committee during this parliamentary session. I'd like to thank you for your commitment to maintaining an open and constructive dialogue with the committee and the ScotRail Alliance, and I'm sure I speak for the whole committee when I say that I hope this relationship will continue with the successor committee. Thank you very much, and I now suspend briefly for a witness changeover. resume this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. The third agenda item is to take evidence from the Minister for Transport and Islands on general transport matters. I welcome Derek Mackay, Minister for Transport and Islands, and his officials Aidan Grisewood, Director of Rail, John Nicholls, Director of Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals, and Michelle Rennie, Director of Major Transport Infrastructure Projects, all from Transport Scotland. And I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Convener and Committee. This morning I intend to share with you the excellent progress made in transport since we last met in October, despite very challenging weather conditions. The annual Scottish Transport Statistics published just last week provide an encouraging insight into areas in which we are performing well, together with indications where more work will be beneficial in continuing to deliver our transport vision. Once again, we have seen an increase in rail use and cycling, a clear sign that our continued investment in these areas is paying dividends. The Scottish Government is currently delivering the most extensive investment programme in our railways ever, a tune of around £5 billion up to 2019. And while there's been a small decline in bus use, we've remained committed to supporting bus services through the £240 million made available through the Bus Service Operators Grant and concession rate bus travel. And we're also pushing forward with the introduction of smart ticketing, which will be rolled out across more transport services going forward. One of the more encouraging signs is the fact that almost three quarters of all journeys to school are made by active or public transport, and this provides a real opportunity to encourage the next generation to leave the car behind whilst providing the environmental and health benefits now. And while the increase in car registrations reflect the ongoing economic recovery in Scotland, the Scottish Government remains focused on reducing emissions and congestion by encouraging a greater number of journeys by public and active travel. So we're investing more than £1 billion per annum to get people out of their cars, including overall investment in active travel to a record £39.2 million for 2015-16, matching last year's record investment in cycling and walking. Now, the latest statistics confirm the trend identified during the refresh exercise of the National Transport Strategy, which was undertaken in partnership with COSLA, and I saw this refresh as the beginning of a conversation that I think will lead to a fuller, more collaborative review, comprehensive review of the National Transport Strategy in the next Parliament with the next government. Now, I appeared before you just a few weeks ago about the closure of the Forth Road Bridge in early December, and I paid tribute to all staff involved for the swift and dedicated actions undertaken in often challenging circumstances to repair the fault, carry out further maintenance and reopen the bridge to all traffic ahead of schedule on the 20th of February, a feat which has been described as a remarkable achievement by an independent suspension bridge expert. On the rail network, part of the Lamington Viaduct was left on the brink of failure by flood damage caused by Storm Frank on New Year's Eve, and its closure, it was decided. Thanks to the efforts of all those people who have worked so hard in securing and rebuilding the structure, especially amid challenging weather conditions, vital passenger and freight services that rely on the West Coast mainline resumed ahead of schedule. Now, ahead of the forthcoming 20-week closure of the Queen Street Station high-level tunnel, I've launched in mid-January ScotRail Alliance's communications campaign to inform the public of the changes to the timetables. And although I understand this work will cause some inconvenience to passengers at Network Rail, ScotRail Alliance is working to ensure that services are maintained where possible, disruption is kept to a minimum, and that passengers are kept well informed throughout the work. Mid-January, I was pleased to welcome colleagues from all our island authorities to the first meeting of the Islands Transport Forum. Effective and reliable transport links are essential for island communities, and we have constructive talks on the main issues, in particular beginning to focus on air services, where I believe we've made some significant progress. The recent increase from 40% to 50% in the air discount scheme, itself extended until 2019, offers a significant discount on airfares for travellers from remote communities, and the new regular ferry service near Dross and Campbelltown route is one of a number of enhancements being brought forward as part of this summer's timetable, which will increase overall capacity across the Clyde and Hebrides network and make sure we get the most from our ferry fleet. And talking about our ferry fleet, I'm delighted to have cut the first steel on the first of our two new 100-metre ferries, marking the start of the construction of this massive £97 million investment project, bringing commercial shipbuilding back to the Clyde. These vessels will also be dual-fuel ferries, allowing them to use cleaner fuel and future-proofing them for the advent of tighter regulations around sulphur emissions. Finally, recent analysis of the rollout of road equivalent tariff to Islay, Colonsay and Gia in 2012 shows an increase in the passenger numbers and a rise in the number of visitors to the islands, showing that RET is doing what we said it would do, promoting our islands by reducing the cost of ferry travel, making them more attractive to visitors and helping support those local economies. But on road safety, in the first year of operation of the new average speed cameras on the A9, there were no fatal accidents anywhere on the route from July to December. These improvements are taking place with rising traffic volumes and continuing use of this nationally important route to support the economy of the Highlands and Islands. We are monitoring the performance of the A9 and welcome the figures that indicate the route continues to perform far more safely than was the case before. Every road death is one too many, and that is why we remain steadfastly committed to reducing casualty numbers even further as we continue to work with all partners to reach our ambitious road safety targets for 2020. And at the end of January, we announced £24 million funding to take forward the design and construction of a new grade-separated junction at Lawrence Kirk, which has been a long-standing commitment of the Scottish Government. The funding boost for Lawrence Kirk is part of an extra £254 million we're investing as part of Aberdeen City deal, adding to our already impressive transport infrastructure investment portfolio, which includes the £745 million Aberdeen bypass, £170 million improvements to the Aberdeen-Inverness rail line, improved road access in the A96 at Inverramsey Bridge, dualling the A9 between Aberdeen and Inverness, and preparation work to begin to remove the notorious bottleneck at the Hodigan roundabout. The fourth replacement crossing is being built on time and under budget, and I'm aware that the committee received a full briefing on this from the project team just last week. Construction work on the M8, M73 and M74 motorway improvements is well underway and scheduled for completion for spring 2017. Work is progressing well. I see I'm trying your patience, convener, so we're also making good progress on the A9 dualling, other joint ventures and the AWPR. And I will now take any questions you may have. But, convener, if you allow me to say, I think that's an impressive record of transport interventions since we last discussed them.
Thank you very much, Minister. Just picking up a couple of points that you mentioned. First of all, road equivalent tariff. Are there any plans to roll out RET to those islands that are not currently benefiting from it? And I'm thinking particularly of the Northern Islands.
The commitment from the government was to roll it out across the Chiefs area and to then look to the Northern Isles, because there's a different impact in the Northern Isles, because this is about distance ultimately and the equivalent, as it says, of road travel. So it is an issue that the government's actively considering in partnership with the local authorities through the Island Area Ministerial Working Group. Although its work is concluded, there's ongoing stag appraisal work and other route service methodology work that's considering the ferry options for the future to the Northern Isles. So the answer to your question is yes, we're looking at a model for the future that covers other islands that don't currently benefit. But there are some islands, such as Shetland, if you do it purely on an equivalent road basis, it doesn't work for them, and you have to look at the methodology, which, having completely fulfilled the government's manifesto in this term, is certainly something for the next government to consider.
OK, and if I heard you correctly, and no doubt you'll correct me if I didn't, you said £5 billion of investment in public transport to encourage people out of their cars and into alternative modes of transport. Was that right? Is that
£1 billion a year approximately on public transport and £5 billion for the control period for rail investment.
Right. OK, that's helpful. I'm going to hand over to Alec Johnson.
Thank you very much, convener. The Minister didn't leave many questions to ask. The statement was so comprehensive, but he didn't mention high-speed rail. So, could I begin by asking if you've received the results of the study being carried out by HS2 into the extension of the proposed high-speed rail network into Scotland?
Well, it's unlike Alec Johnson to ask a difficult question that I didn't cover, because Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary, leads on high-speed rail work, and there is an announcement due. And we're doing it in partnership with the UK government, because this is clearly a project that requires the cooperation of the UK government and Scottish government. And therefore, yes, reports have been received into the broad options study, and that will require further UK government, Scottish government cooperation to be in a place where...
What's about these reports at the moment?
Absolutely nothing.
Mm-hmm. So can I take it then that we can expect a formal announcement at some time?
Yes, you can, before the PERDA period.
Uh-huh. That's very interesting. Media reports indicate that the decision not to proceed with a standalone Edinburgh-Glasgow high-speed rail line was taken following consideration of a draft business case for the project in 2014. Can you outline the contents of that draft business case and explain why it was never published?
I can't outline it, and the reason is, as I've said in the previous statements to Parliament, is really that the work there was more advanced in the aspirations of having high-speed rail to Scotland, the benefits of it, having it physically come to Scotland in between Glasgow and Edinburgh as well. And as the works were considered, it was clear that it makes sense, before you proceed with the Edinburgh to Glasgow route, that you should know what's happening coming from south of the border and do it together, and that's exactly what we have been doing. So both will be published at the same time in an open and transparent way, and the Keith Brown statement, I think, will be able to cover much more of that. So I can't give the content exclusively of the Edinburgh to Glasgow element, because it's very much part of the bigger picture now.
Thank you. I'll now jump to an issue that you did cover in your opening statement, and that is the development that's going on in the road network. You mentioned the M8 completion project, and I was along that road for the first time in daylight about 6 months the other day, and I see there's huge amounts of work being carried out since I last saw it. When do you expect that project to be completed?
2017, the spring of.
Uh-huh. The dualling of the A9 is a longer-term project. Is there anything more you can tell us about the schedule that will be adopted for the complete dualling of the A9?
So it's on track for 2025.
Mm-hmm.
If you want individual detailed elements of the 12 sections of it, I can do that, but I'm being more... contained in my answers to be more direct and helpful with
okay.
time.
The final road project that is ongoing is the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, which is again one that I observe on a regular basis when I'm going around the northeast. Can you tell us what the current position is in relation to that, and whether any further work is going on to improve relationships with the project, the construction project, and local people who are having difficulties as a result of that project's continuation?
Okay, the project is on schedule to open to traffic in the winter of 2017, so it's very much on track. Some of the other advantages of it include the use of a skills pledge around apprentices as well. In terms of engagement, I think Transport Scotland and the operators and contractors, we do try and encourage good relationships with local communities through exhibitions explaining what's going on, real information about what's happening and progress that's being made, and offering people up to be accessible for meetings. So if Alec Johnson has any issues around a lack of accessibility or information, I'm more than happy to address that, but there should be an adequate sharing of progress.
My experience is that it's a long construction project. It goes through a lot of areas where people's lives are being disrupted one way or another, so difficulties are inevitable. And all I really seek from the Minister is an assurance that he will work on his side to encourage engagement with people to work these problems out whenever the opportunity exists.
Absolutely. And it is a fair point to say that when there is such a construction project, the end benefits are absolutely worth it. But during that period of disruption, it can impact in people's lives. Therefore, good engagement, consultation, and a bit of compassion, of course, I would expect, and proactively pursue.
The Minister mentioned the junction at Lawrencekirk, which a funding announcement has now been made. And all I seek to do by raising the matter once again is to ask the Minister to confirm that the decisions that have been made and the announcements that have been made now ensure that the road, that junction, will be upgraded to a grade-separated junction and that it will be funded from within Scottish Government budgets.
Yes. However, there are issues of planning obligations that were live before the Scottish Government's announcement, and if we can get further planning contribution, as you would expect, from developers, if that's appropriate, we'd still proceed on that basis. I established a partnership to take forward before the Government's announcement on funding to try and work together to ensure that everyone that had a stake was able to contribute towards its actual delivery. You know, so if there's legitimate and reasonable contributions to be made towards that transport project, we should still receive them, but there's a commitment to see it through to completion.
Is there, at this stage, any prospect that the Minister could give us a timescale for achieving completion of that upgrade?
I think that's quite ambitious, Mr. Johnston, and it would be particularly ambitious for me to set out a timescale at this time. I mean, obviously, there's many stages to go through in terms of detailed design and all the necessary legislative and order requirements. So I think I would be setting up an ambitious and potentially misleading date if I was to attempt it right now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much indeed. And I hope, Convener, that you're impressed with the speed I went through that.
And the answers.
Absolutely.
Indeed.
Brevity and questions and answers is always welcome. Claire.
Thank you, Convener. As Mr. Johnson said, you've left very little for us to ask you, Minister, with that comprehensive introduction. I was, however, very pleased to hear the emphasis on safety in our roads, and I was wondering if you could tell us what the Government will continue to do, especially working with small to medium enterprises, about the use of telematics to monitor driver performance in commercial vehicles, and what the Government's current position is on black box technology for new drivers, and whether the Government has a position on the possibility of graduated licensing being introduced to improve safety in younger drivers.
Okay, so we take road safety very seriously. The long-term direction of travel, pardon the pun, was reassuring fatalities and casualties coming down. I think we've made substantial progress from the baseline figure. That said, any fatality is regrettable, and we want zero fatalities, of course we do. So we've currently refreshed our framework and our targets. You know, the UK Government doesn't set targets in this area, we do. It helps drive performance, so we're working with the full partnership to improve a number of work streams, and we've got specific categories we feel that are more vulnerable, and it includes, you know, vulnerable road users such as pedestrians and cyclists, motorcyclists, and actually younger and older drivers as well. So there's a range of interventions we can make, social media campaigns, area specific campaigns, rural roads, encouraging 20 mile per hour zones and built up areas. So there's a range of actions that if it hasn't been published already, and I think it is this week, it has been signed off in terms of road safety and that framework. I think that will assist and show the sense of priority that we have. Your specific questions, black box technology, some of these areas are out with our competency and rest with the UK Government, either the Department of Transport or the DVLA, but we are supportive. We're accused of being the nanny state, but you know what? Government's here to help, and if there are further interventions we can make, then we're happy to look at that. And to answer specifically on graduated driving licences, yes, we do support such interventions, including pilots, and I know I've given that answer before in Parliament. But again, out with our direct competence, but something that we have supported and indeed lobbied UK Government for.
Thank you very much, Minister. Can I finally ask just about the National Transport Strategy, which has recently undergone a refresh, and could you give us an update on that? And also, you've indicated that a full review should take place during the next session of the Parliament, and I just wonder if you could give us some information. Obviously, we don't know who might be in charge of that at this stage, but also give us an indication of how that consultation will take place.
That's the second time in a fortnight that I've been told I won't be the Transport Minister any longer, but the National transport strategy as it said on the tin. It was a refresh. It was to bring up to speed, up to date to all the relevant policy elements of it. You know, we've made such great progress on climate change, on targets, on cycling, on walking strategy, on community planning, that all of those elements should fit within the National Transport Strategy and be updated, because it was some time since its last iteration or publication. So it's been refreshed, agreed unanimously by COSLA at a meeting last year, which I particularly welcome the engagement that we had, but also a workshop of other stakeholders as well from across the transport world. And the reason we committed to a fuller review is, I know we've discussed this before, felt that the timing wasn't right for a comprehensive review, and there was a greater opportunity. Indeed, it was suggested by this committee and other stakeholders that aligning it with the Strategic Transports Projects Review and also the National Planning Framework makes sense, so that the next Parliament will have that opportunity to totally comprehensively go through those policies. But I think it's in a good place, and it's certainly fit for purpose. It's updated policy and hasn't changed the fundamentals, which is public transport is good, is worth investing in, and we make the right policy interventions to encourage people out of the car into public transport. And we've enjoyed more success in, for example, rail than we have on buses. So it's further strengthened our view that we need to do more to support the bus sector.
Just a very brief point, Minister. I'm a very strong supporter of looking at new aviation routes. For example, from Broadford to Glasgow, you'll be aware of High's report today, which I think endorses the economic benefits of that. Do you share that view? And also in the horizons, do you see the positive changes that the CAA are recommending, which, as you know, is about single-engined aircraft, which means that routes that are perhaps not viable now would be viable with single engine because, as you know, there'd be less staffing requirements and they're more economical in terms of the number of passengers they can carry. What's your view on that?
Of course, my first point would be that adopting the government's position on APD, air passenger duty, would help new routes to Scotland generally, and is a good thing to do for economic growth, new routes and sustaining the routes that we have. Slightly separate issues for some of the airports that Hyle covers because of the exemptions that are there. In terms of the specific proposal for a new airport, and you know, the times of austerity, we have to balance our budgets. Hyle, like all agencies, will have to consider their costs and operate efficiently. What I've said around the prospect of any further new airports is, you know, I'm a listening minister. If there's a proposition to be put, then, you know, I'm willing to hear from stakeholders that might have a view around the cost-benefit ratio or what it can do to unlock local economic potential. And there's been work done in the past in that respect. But we will continue to support HIAL particularly and operators to expand routes generally in Scotland and to support those communities that are more remote. And we've done it through the air discount scheme, of course, increasing the subsidy from 40 to 50%, direct intervention and support for HIAL. And there has been a couple of new routes announced recently, which, you know, I think should be welcomed and showing that we are trying to do what David Stewart has requested within very tight financial resources. But it is ambitious to propose a new airport, but I've said I'm happy to engage in the subject, but we'll need far more by way of economic certainty as to who would use such a facility. Does that assist?
Thank you. And finally, Kaveri, perhaps if the Minister hasn't already seen it, it just came out today, I'd certainly recommend the HIE's report on this very issue.
I have engaged with a number of members on this subject, and just a week or two ago, Dave Thompson specifically. So I'm well aware of the issue. I've not seen today's report, but I'm aware of the requests for that proposal. And I say I'm happy to engage in it, but I think we've got a long way to go before we commit to a new operational airport.
Thank you. Can I move on to active travel, Minister? You mentioned in your opening statement that investment in active travel is at a record level. You said that a quarter of all journeys to school are now by active travel, if I heard you correctly.
Actually, three quarters by public transport or active travel.
So, right.
Public transport or active travel, three quarters, I think, is what I said.
Did you? Right, okay. But, of course, the figure for cycling and walking has been pretty static over the last decade. And the transport statistics that you mentioned show that cycling as the usual means of transport to school is 1.7% up from 1.2%. So obviously the trajectory is in the right direction, but that's still a very modest figure. And I'm just wondering, given how important safety is, for, particularly for children travelling to school, what role further investment in cycling infrastructure can make to driving up those figures?
So I think there are a few interventions that will help. First of all, well, the record funding on active travel and infrastructure, I think, should be welcomed again, a very challenging financial environment. There are particular behaviour change projects as well. There's also the Community Links Plus design competition, which, convener, you were instrumental in taking forward to have an exemplar project of showing how in urban areas we can encourage more people to cycle, which has been delivered on that cross-party basis. I also convened an active travel summit to bring local authorities to the table to try and encourage active travel as well. Now, I was disappointed by the attendance. It was in Inverness, I have to say, and I was disappointed that more local authorities weren't present, more senior figures weren't present. And that's why when I published the National Transport Strategy and wrote to each local authority leader, I drew out important issues for me, and active travel was one, because it is largely local, although government will do what we can. And we have also commissioned a piece of work around the school run. So what more can we do to encourage people to use active travel for the school run? And I'll come back to the committee once I have a fuller update on that. Because if we get it right and we encourage people to do it at an early age, then hopefully they'll continue to take active travel choices for the rest of their life. If you think there's any dubiety about the figures on mode to school, I'm happy to provide more detail to the committee.
I think we trust the statistics. I think it's just more about how we drive the figures in the right direction.
So there is the cycling action plan, which leads to a number of actions. There's a record investment, there's the behaviour change, and there's the bikeability, which is in a number of schools at the moment. I think from memory the figure was around 40-odd percent of schools involved in the bikeability project, but again, I can check that out. So I think there's a range of packages and within the schools, improving infrastructure. Also why I encourage more 20-mile-per-hour schemes in urban areas as well. I think Edinburgh is leading on this. Consultation, of course, is the right thing to do and is required rather than a top-down approach from government. And the record funding that we've put into active travel is all significant. So we've extended the pathways and the cycle routes over the last number of years as a consequence of that extra resource. So I suppose there's examples of interventions.
And the point you make about local authorities, and it's clear from what you've said that there's a variation in the level of commitment that local authorities have to taking forward the active travel agenda, and that's perhaps reflected in the fact that there's also a variation in cycling rates between local authorities. So Transport Scotland's local area analysis for 2014 shows that 11.8% of journeys to work were made by bike in Edinburgh, but only 0.3% in Renfrewshire. So what is Transport Scotland doing to share best practice between authorities, and what are you doing as Transport Minister to provide further leadership to the local authorities? I mean, I absolutely commend you for all the work that you've done and for convening the Active Travel Summit of local authorities. But if, as you say, if they're only sending people who are of a junior position within their local authority, how do we get them to take it seriously?
I think in some respects, convener, population, local communities will have to say to local authorities, this is a priority for them. It should come through community planning. I'm saying it's a priority for government. It's clear in the action plan, the cycling action plan, the walking strategy, the national transport strategy, or health policies, education policies, as well as transport policies, to share expertise. Specifically, as you've asked, we do now have a Smarter Choices, Smarter Places learning network that does exactly that shares good practice and what's working to try and improve the delivery in every local authority area. The first annual networking workshop will take place later this month, as it happens. So apart from making it clear in transport policy this should be a priority, the record investment, the exemplar project, which I think will set out to local authorities what can be done. There has been other exemplar projects, but I'll show...
Project.
I don't have it here, but it's to... Well, I can give you as much as I know at the moment that we've committed to that investment, that the Community Links Plus design competition will provide significant funding for one or two exemplar on-road segregated cycling schemes over the next 2 to 3 years, with the aim of being able to bring about step change in the levels of cycling for short journeys in target communities. And as you'll be aware, convener, we say we'll do that in partnership with local authorities, and it'll be led by Sustrans, as you would expect. So we have made a significant commitment around supporting that and making it happen after the cross-party meeting that we held. So clarity in policy, resources allocated, making it clear as Transport Minister to local authorities this matters, engaging with community plan partnerships to focus on this, and then encourage the right kind of interventions and guidance and support to deliver it. But on this subject, because most of the journeys are local, local authority leaders will have to lead and deliver at the most local level. And this isn't a government, as we all know, wedded to ring-fenced budgets, but this is one of the few areas that we still have ring-fenced budgets to local government, which was around walking, safer walking routes, I think, to schools, one of the few remaining ring-fenced budgets, in addition to some of the interventions that I've made. So it's a priority for the government, but I do believe there has to be more local leadership on this subject. Yes, I do.
Okay, and finally, on the issue of investment, as a committee, we received a range of evidence from stakeholders involved in active travel and cycling. During our budget scrutiny exercise, and one of the proposals from Spokes, the cycling organisation in the Lothians, was that 1% of the trunk road budget should be transferred to active travel, which would amount to something like an additional £8 million in the current financial year. There was also a more ambitious proposal that 10% of the transport budget be spent on active travel. Will you commit to either of those figures or to increasing, maintaining and increasing the active travel budget in the years to come?
Well, I think by my actions, I've ensured that it reached a record level and then sustained that record level whilst, you know, quite challenging times within the transport budget. The reason I don't believe in an arbitrary figure on proportion of spend or an arbitrary number, I mean, discount something. For example, cyclists use roads too. So is investment in other roads, you know, a bad thing for cyclists? Of course it's not. Investing in roads is, you know, good for cyclists as well. So an arbitrary figure I don't think would be helpful, apart from the fact that I don't think it's right to simply base allocations for different modes of transport. I mean, if I was to ask the committee, which big project that you've heard about would you not deliver? The Queensferry crossing, the A9 dualling, the new routes to island communities for ferries, the purchasing. So, you know, I think there are priorities, and we've set out what the government's priorities are while supporting active travel. And government has clear contractual obligations, maintenance and upgrade requirements. So I think we've done a lot in active travel. There is certainly more to do, but you can't, I think, separate out road investment as in saying it, suggesting that it doesn't support cycling when, you know, cyclists use roads too. So I don't support an arbitrary formula, convener, no.
I think, I'm not sure that the cycling lobby would agree with you, but we'll leave it at that. I'm going to pass over to Adam to ask some questions.
Okay, thanks, convener. If I could start by asking about Borders Rail issues. We had asked Phil Verster in our previous session this morning about plans for improvement in rolling stock. For is this something that's on your, that has crossed your desk, Minister, and have you pressed for any action on this front?
Well, it's a very good question. We had looked at, is there any spare capacity within the current rolling stock to assist? I mean, what's some would argue, a good problem to have. It's so popular, people want more. And that contrasts with some people who said, including at least one opposition politician that said it would be a big white elephant, it would never work, and that member would never use it. And I understand there's now a frequent user of Borders Railway. So it is a success story. If we had the spare rolling stock, Alec Johnson, I think, is asking who it is. I won't name the Conservative member because you might be embarrassed by it. But Mr. Ingram is right to say...
Minister, please feel free.
I think it's polite to move on, convener. But if we had spare capacity of rolling stock, of course it would make sense to deploy here. We don't have that spare rolling stock at the moment, and therefore some difficulty to expand it. We did make some modifications, improvements by way of enhancement. But I think the big progress will be made when the high-speed trains, where we have deployed, and the new electric trains are deployed for the Edinburgh to Glasgow route, and that will give us the opportunity to cascade the existing rolling stock. And I know that that is some time off between, I suppose, 2017-2018 timescale, but at that point we'll have more rolling stock. We can cascade it around the network and help meet need, and I think Borders would have a very reasonable call for enhanced rolling stock.
Thanks for that. The other issue with regards to Borders Rail, the campaign for Borders Rail is calling for the Scottish Government to extend the railway to Hawick and Carlisle. Is this something on your radar? Are you considering this, Minister, or is it somewhere in the distance?
There are a number of requests at the moment to extend passenger railway services from a number of members and a number of communities, and more often than not comes from a local promoter going through the necessary appraisal, stag appraisal and so on. What we've said we'll do is we'll support the local transport partnership, SESTRAN as it happens to be, of course, to look at the advice, to work up a case that they can then inform a stag report, so that appraisal of transport options. So Transport Scotland will assist in that, but it will be for the local transport partnership to proceed with that work, and I understand that they intend to appoint a contractor to undertake the study fairly soon, so it will be in SESTRAN's hands to proceed with that, and we'll be supportive. So no immediate plans to extend the railway, but there's a process to go through, and we'll be supportive of advising that process, and then any future commitments around expansion of railways will be considered as part of a control period review and all other finances at the time, looking at any business case that may emerge.
Okay, the Minister has mentioned his ambition to be reappointed after the elections. I won't be joining him because I'm not coming back here, but I'd like to appeal to him on behalf of colleagues in the southwest of Scotland. We look on enviously with all the transport infrastructure developments elsewhere in Scotland, the North East Highlands and the Edinburgh-Glasgow corridor, and we're wondering if we can get a piece of that action in the southwest of Scotland, Ayrshire, Dumfries and Galloway. Can you hold out any hopes for us that developments will be coming forward in that area in the future?
I don't think Mr. Ingram would expect me at this stage to be able to offer a new transport project in this fashion, other than to say I understand that the regional issues that exist and exist around connectivity, as well as some of the economic growth issues as well, but wonderful opportunity around tourism as well as accessibility and joining up some of the potential there. So as with all new transport projects, it requires promoters and leadership and a business case to come forward. But I hear the case that's been made by Mr. Ingram, and I'll certainly bear it in mind. And if it's not me, then my successor will be informed of your request as well.
Well, I can assure you there will be proposals coming forward. The other, just finally, you've mentioned a couple of times, Minister, the need to perhaps look at bus services. A lot of emphasis has been placed on rail. But we do know from our own constituency mailbags, we get an awful lot of issues and concerns with regards to bus services in our areas, or the lack of bus services. Could you maybe develop a wee bit your thinking, what you're thinking in this regard?
Well, first of all, the National Transport Strategy, one of the objectives I wanted to achieve was greater clarity in who's responsible for what. So in the scenario that there is a lack of a bus service at a local level, the local authority, or if appropriate, the transport partnership can intervene to support the creation of a route through going through the necessary process, but they can intervene. You know, when I was a council leader, I don't think I realised the opportunity and the powers that I had at the time to support communities where there was a lack of service provision. So if a case can be made, a local authority absolutely can intervene. Rather than wash their hands of the issue and say, oh, that's the private sector, or that's for someone else to fix, or the government. I mean, we deliver the National Concessionary Travel Scheme, the Bus Service Operators Grant, or the Greener Bus Fund, but we don't set local routes. Traffic Commissioner, so on, has a regulatory role. So I think if there are gaps in service provision through the local transport strategy, community planning, or direct intervention, the local authority can act, first of all, in the scenario that there is a lack of service. But more widely, I don't think it's a lack of investment that's led to a falling patronage or stagnation for bus passengers. It's maybe the attractiveness of the individual car or the cost of fuel. Maybe some people have opted for train instead of bus. So we need to show that bus is a priority. We've got greener buses. Their emissions are far better when there's a case before. That they're accessible, they're attractive, they're affordable. And that's why we've got the National Concessionary Travel Scheme and other direct subsidies, and make bus more attractive by giving it priority within the transport system. What do I mean by that? Well, for example, local priority. Coordinate with the bus companies where the disruption is going to be if there's roadworks. Give bus priority at, you know, junctions or gates or priority lanes. Whatever the right local intervention is, I think we have to do more to show people public transport is the mode of transport we should try and use first if a journey is necessary, and in most areas that is bus, because the vast majority of all public transport journeys are made by bus. It's just that the growth in bus has stagnated, so very little growth, indeed some decline, whereas rail is soaring, but still far less than bus journeys. So I just think that the bus industry can make progress in partnership with local communities and certainly local authorities. Does that assist?
I certainly look forward to future initiatives in this area. Obviously, the constituency that I represent is largely rural, or has a large rural, and the issue of coverage, bus service coverage, is a constant one, really. So I would really welcome further development of bus services across Scotland.
Thank you. David.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I've got three very quick questions on the Caledonian Sleeper. You'd be well aware that members of the RMT union took industrial action over the Christmas period about concerns about defects to the sleeper rolling stock. What action has Transport Scotland taken to ensure that all sleeper rolling stock is safe for passengers and indeed for staff as well?
Well, first of all, I'm sure the whole committee would welcome the fact that RMT has lifted its dispute with Caledonian Sleeper, so I think that's an important point for everyone to acknowledge. There are very strict safety guidelines in terms of the rail services and what Caledonian Sleepers can operate, and there's a role here as well for the Office of Rail and Road. But what has Transport Scotland done? Well, we expect contractual obligations to be delivered, and we were proactive in ensuring that a number of the concerns that I heard about were raised in terms of, you know, operation and safety and so on. And you know, there has been pressure applied. There is new rolling stock, of course, for the sleeper to be delivered, and much of the rolling stock, or all of it, in fact, of course, was inherited. And it's not necessarily an issue that has just come about recently, but the condition of some of the rolling stock has required that extra maintenance workers, and extra investment, and that's been put in. And, of course, Transport Scotland were pursuing the operator, Serco, throughout.
Okay, thanks. Thank you for that. Minister, could you just be clear to the committee, was there any financial penalties imposed on Circle for operating potentially in safe rolling stock?
If there's a loss of service, it's at the cost of the operator. If they've lost profit due to carriages being out of service, then they essentially have taken the hit for that if it's due to their issues. But no, there's been no formal request of compensation or requirement for us to impose a penalty. Because, if they don't provide a service, they lose the revenue. And if it breaches contractual obligations, then we would certainly initiate any relevant clause.
So within, and I appreciate you won't know every, you won't be able to dot every I on the contract terms, but in general terms, if in theory an operator has unsafe rolling stock, in this particular contract, is there a clause that you can take some particular action against the operator?
Well, can I ask maybe Aidan, you want more detail, it's appropriate here to take the official's detail.
When it comes to issues about safety, then that's clear responsibility for the Office of Rail and Road. So in terms of enforcement of safety standards on the railway, that's their responsibility. So obviously if there are any, safety is absolutely imperative and the railway has a very good track record in this respect. But that would be the Rail Office and Railroad who would act in those circumstances rather than it being a contractual issue.
And through then, the regulator could take financial penalties against the operator if there was a breach of standards of rolling stock?
They would have a range of potential options. I mean, the first thing is that they simply wouldn't be allowed to operate if they were deemed to not be operating safely. And in this case, they haven't reached that conclusion. So the issues that were raised weren't deemed to be breaching safety issues in terms of licence obligations on safety.
Okay, and my final question, Convener. I suppose I'm looking at the flip side of this. Does the contract terms require compensation to Circle for losses following industrial action?
If they can make a case that would be reasonable, they could make an approach. It would be considered by ministers, and we have uniquely a parity clause that we would also engage with the trade unions to make a judgment on what's reasonable and what's not. So they are entitled to approach the government and say, we've incurred loss because of an industrial dispute. They have to explain that, and we uniquely in the UK would go to the trade unions, get their take on it as well, and then make a judgment. And on this issue, for the avoidance of doubt, no such approach has been made.
Just for avoidance of any doubt, I think it would be rather perverse if they did make such an approach, but just I want it to be...
But I mustn't prejudice it either, Mr. Stewart.
Yeah, right. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. I wonder if you could provide an update on the tendering of the Clyde and Hebrides Ferry Service contract.
Okay, so two... final tenders have been received on Monday from CalMac and Serco. They'll be considered, they'll be assessed, and we should meet the timescale of an award, an announcement at the end of May with enactment of a contract on the 1st of October. Of course, a great amount of work has gone in to get us to this stage of the criteria, the waiting, the process. And it's now with officials to produce advice to ministers.
Thank you very much.
I've heard you give many assurances to the users, to the staff, that service levels, fares and the terms of conditions of staff will be fully protected regardless of whichever of the two companies wins the contract. I wonder if you could just, for the record, provide these reassurances again.
Well, absolutely, that would be the case, that all vessels and ports currently under public ownership will remain so. The government will continue to set the routes, the timetables, the fares and the policies as appropriate and as we do now, so nothing will change. Things that have changed since the last time this was procured, I've enhanced the quality aspect of the waiting. I've guaranteed that it will be a fair, affordable and sustainable CalMac pension scheme will be written into the contract, whoever the operator is, and there's a high proportion of the overall marks been allocated on HR strategy, human resources strategy. So I think there, as I've previously debated, enhancements they've made to the process from last time round, and the guarantee continues around that element of public service.
Thank you very much, Minister. And just moving on to the subject of the fourth replacement crossing, the committee heard from the team last week, Transport Scotland officials, and we were, you know, I think all delighted that that project is under budget and on time. But I just wondered if a date has been set for the opening of the bridge towards the end of this year.
Well, I hope that the briefing has been consistent, that it will be complete on time by the end of this year. So I don't have a date, and I won't set a date, because I think that would be quite presumptive at this stage of the process. Apart from anything else, if it is later in the year and it is in the winter, as we all know, with our transport expertise, then there may be other issues that impact. But there is no date set, is the short answer to your question, but it's very much on track.
Thank you very much.
Final questions from members? David.
Just a very, very brief point, Minister. You'll know that we had a very useful session earlier with ScotRail, and obviously the issue about the Deep Alliance was flagged up, which seems to me a very positive idea. Obviously, I appreciate that the Caledon Sleeper and the Virgin London services have already been let, and these are longer-term contracts. But is there any general discussion from government terms about having some closer links with the Sleeper and the Virgin London service with Network Rail in light of what's happening with the ScotRail services?
I'm not really sure. I mean, I think Aidan would probably be best placed to answer that.
There's lots of different relationships between different train operating companies and Network Rail, depending on the nature of the service. I think in Scotland, particularly well placed to have a deep alliance because of a single dominant operator and a route, a Scotland route that coincides with that dominant operator. So that was a particular opportunity, and the benefits are much clearer around a deeper alliance. I guess when it comes in terms of the sleeper, it runs on quite a few routes depending on what's going on in any particular night. So having that deep sort of commercial relationship and single management team really is less appropriate for an operator such as the sleeper. That's not to say that they've got to work closely with Network Rail. And actually, in a Scottish context, it's really important, and the regulator too has an important role to play to make sure that the Deep Alliance doesn't work in a way that could potentially discriminate against other operators. And that's something we're very alive to. I think, I don't know, I wasn't here to listen to the questioning of Phil Verster. I know that they are too, and the regulator keeps a very close eye on that as well as part of their responsibilities for equal access.
But that said, can I just say one thing about the Deep Alliance? It's to agree with David Stewart that I think the alliance is working very well. I think it's, you know, the Thatcher years fractured the railways. I thought that would get Mr. Johnson's interest, and actually bringing towards deeper integration is a good thing, and it's working well and being able to make decisions in Scotland more quickly about our railways. And I think it's one of the reasons we've made progress in engineering projects as well as wider investment priorities. So as a project, that the Alliance, I believe, is working well.
Okay. Do you have any final remarks you'd like to place on the record, Minister?
No thanks, Convener.
Okay. Can I thank the Minister and his officials for attending today's meeting, and the Minister for his update on general transport matters. This will probably be your last appearance before this committee in this session of Parliament, and so I'd like to take this opportunity on behalf of the committee to thank you for the constructive way in which you've engaged with the committee during your term of office as Minister for Transport and the Islands. We look forward to continuing this constructive engagement between your successor and our successor committee, and I will now suspend this meeting briefly for a witness changeover. item this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Agenda item 4 is petition PE1236. The committee will consider an update from Transport Scotland regarding this petition from Jill Fotheringham, calling on the Scottish Government to improve safety measures on the A90 by constructing a grade-separated junction where the A937 crosses the A90 at Lawrence Kirk. I refer members to paper 4, which has an update from Transport Scotland attached and confirms that it will provide £24 million of funding to take forward the design and construction of a grade-separated junction at the A90 A937 South Junction at Lawrence Kirk, as the petitioner has requested. The letter indicates that the next stage in the scheme development is to progress with the design phases of the junction upgrade. Transport Scotland will look to appoint consultants and begin work to take the scheme through design, development and statutory authorisation. The committee is invited to consider and agree whether it wishes to take any further action in relation to the petition. The committee has the option to close the petition should it consider that its objectives have been met. Should the committee wish to keep the petition open, the committee would be required to add the petition to its legacy paper for its successor committee to consider further in session 5. Can I invite comments from members? Alex.
My comment is so near and yet so far. I am delighted that the government have now allocated funds and made this a priority going forward. However, the answers that we receive from the minister indicate that there is one potential issue still within this, and that is where the minister indicated that there was an expectation that or a possibility that they might seek local planning development funding for this junction. The problem locally is that planners see their commitment to developing the local road network and junctions as focused on a different junction, the North Junction to Lawrence Kirk, which is the one that's likely to be used by commuters who live in the homes that will be built there. There is a view that has been expressed locally and by planning applicants that any attempt to use planning funding to develop the South Junction would actually be open to legal challenge and unlikely to succeed. So my concern is that the government have not yet conceded that funding achieved through local planning developments would not be allocated to this junction. Therefore, my concerns remain adequate enough to suggest that this petition might be retained.
Do other members have any comments to make? No. Are we agreed that we wish to keep this petition open? Is that the view of the committee? Yeah. Agreed. We will leave the petition open and add the petition to its legacy paper for our successor committee to consider further in session 5. Agenda item 5, subordinate legislation. The fifth item for today is the consideration of 3 negative instruments: the Concession Contract Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/65, the Concession Contract Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/125, and the Utilities Contract Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/49. Paper 5 summarises the purpose and prior consideration of these instruments. These instruments are part of a suite of measures to enact changes to procurement law, and the committee took oral evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities at its meeting on the 24th of February regarding the measures. The committee will now consider any issues it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on these instruments. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to the instruments. And I now invite comments from members. There appear to be no comments from members. Does the committee agree that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to these instruments?
Agreed.
We are agreed. I now move this meeting into private session.